رمضان 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 يا حبيب رمضان رمضان ليتك دوما قريب.
سيدنا فقيه أبو الليث سمرقندي رحمه الله, he mentions about the father that on the day of judgment the children, the wife and the family members, they will make a claim in the court of Allah Jalla Wa'ala. And what is their claim? They will say to Allah Jalla Wa'ala, this is my father who did not teach me deen. This is my father who did not teach me ahkam of deen. Oh Allah, it's because of him today that I am going to hellfire. And what will happen after that? You know, our parents today, father does not want his daughter to wear hijab. They train the daughters in such a way. Why? Because she cannot fit in that community. I get so many people. I get mothers coming to me, my daughter who doesn't wear hijab, give me some taweez. Why my father, my husband doesn't want her to wear hijab? Why? He wants her to fit in that community, to suit that community. Because he feels that he will be distanced from the community. He will be isolated from the community. This is the situation that we are in. This is for those parents. On the day of judgment, the children will say, oh Allah, he is the one who oppressed us. Oh Allah, he is the one who took the deen away from us. He is the one who did not teach us deen. And what will happen? Faqih Abu Layth Samarqandi rahmatullah ta'ala says, this person will have mountains of good deeds. He will be a very pious person. He will not be a sinful person. And the mountains of good deeds will be placed on the scale and he will be taken to the scale. His relatives will come, his children will come, his wife will come. They will take the good deeds. You didn't teach us deen, we will take your good deeds. You did not teach us ahkam of deen, we will take your good deeds. And then he says, gradually all his good deeds will be taken and he will be left with no good deeds at all. And do you know what will happen then? They will say, we need more good deeds. The sins of the children will be placed on the shoulder of the father. The sins of the wife will be placed on the shoulder of the father. Then what will happen after that? Then, this is a very strong jumlah, very strong statement. The angels, they will observe this, and then the father will say, oh children, oh children, now I have on my shoulder the sins that I committed for your pleasure. I'm only left with that. You wanted the best car, you wanted the best property, I used to commit haram, I used to earn haram only to please you. Now I am left with all the sins that I committed for you only. He will be a pious person. He will do everything else. He will be a pious person. He will be an ibadat guzar person. But he did not teach his children. And only haram that he committed was for the sake of his children. And then the angel will say, what an unfortunate person. What an unfortunate person. What a deprived person that he was so pious, but his Allah destroyed him today. He's going to hellfire because of his children. It's our responsibility. When we give sadaqah, get our children, train our children, give them sahaba, make them generous, teach them generosity, make them people with an open heart. That happens from the very beginning. Imam Abu Mansur Maturidi rahimahullah says that the way it's necessary to teach them ahkam of deen, in the same way it's necessary to make them sakhi and teach them sahabat. Allahumma akbar kabira. So that was the first principle in thanking. Second principle is eat together and eat with family members. Rather than the son upstairs in his own room, the daughter in the kitchen, the father in the front room, the mother in the living room. When you do iftar, sit together and do iftar. When you do sahur, sit together and do sahur. I have many ahadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and aqwal of sahaba alayhi radhiyallahu anhu. How the families are united when you sit together and eat. There's so much barakah, there's so much nur in eating together. And the benefit of that, inshallah, in the future, we will mention that sometime. One hadith, Sayyidina Jabir radiallahu ta'ala narrates the Prophet said, إِنَّ أَحَبَّ التَّعَامِ لِلَّهِ مَا قَصُرَتْ عَلَيْهِ أَيْدِي. Sayyidina Jabir bin Abdullah radiallahu ta'ala said, the Prophet said, the best of all foods is that food towards which many hands are raised. Many people are eating together. That is the best of all ta'ams. Imam Muslim of Abu Ya'la, Imam Abu Ya'la narrates that. وعن جابر رضي الله تعالى عنه قال سمعت رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم يقول طعام الواحد يكفي الاثنين وطعام الاثنين يكفي الاربعة وطعام الاربعة يكفي الثمانية. Imam Muslim narrates that, Imam Tirmizi, Imam Ibn Majah, the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم said, the food of one is sufficient for two, the food of two is sufficient for four, and the food of four is sufficient for eight people. That's the blessing that is created within the food. Also eat less. Do not overeat at iftar and sahur time. That defeats the purpose. The purpose of fasting is we eat less. We make sure we act upon the hadith of the Prophet ﷺ, one third for food, one third for drink, and one third for breath. That is the hadith of the Prophet ﷺ. That is the training. And we will work on that in the month of Ramadan and act upon that after the month of Ramadan also for the coming 11 months. And the benefit of that is Rasulullah ﷺ said that Allah Jalla wa Ala loves a slim person. Allah ko dubla patla shakhs acha lagta. So let us act upon that sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wa alihi wasallam also. The other thing that hurts the most, brothers, is wasting food in the month of Ramadan. So much food is wasted. People throw away the food. This is something, it's important in the month of Ramadan, we do not throw any food. And this is my advice for the sisters. Whatever you cook at Sahri time, store the food and keep it for iftar time. And let your family members eat the same food at iftar time. Do not waste food. That food will curse you. That food, when it leaves the household, when it leaves the family, then it will never come back again. It's a ni'mah of Allah Jalla wa Ala that Allah Jalla wa Ala has blessed you with. People say in the month of Ramadan, we shouldn't be stingy. We should spend a lot. Yes, spend a lot, but don't waste it. Spend a lot, do not waste it. Do not throw it away. If you want to feed people, feed them, feed your family members, but do not waste the food. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wa sallam said, a lot of us, you know, even the little pieces of food that remain on the dining table, or that remain on the dining mat, the sheet, that the dastarkhan, all the food that remains, people throw that away. And look at what Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wa sallam has to say about that. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wa sallam said, the one who picks up the pieces of food, the pieces of bread, or the pieces of roti, khubz, chapatis that you eat, or any food, the one who picks it up, Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, Allah blesses him with an opening. Allah opens his ways, Allah opens his path, and his awlad will not have deficiency in the intellect. If you want intelligent awlad, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, pick up the food and eat it. Your children will be intelligent. Think about it, and we throw away the food. Pick up the food from the dastarkhan. Pick up the food from the dining mat, the dining sheet. Pick it up and eat it. Your children will be intelligent. Sayyidina Abdullah ibn Umar radiallahu ta'ala anhuma, once he saw some pieces of food, some roti, some khubz, some bread, and he told his servant, he said, pick it up, clean it and put it aside. The slave picked it up, and then in the evening, Sayyidina Abdullah ibn Umar radiallahu ta'ala anhuma, he asked him, he said, where is the food? He said, I ate it. He said, go, I free you. He said, I ate it. He said, I free you. He said, I'm freeing you. He was his slave. He freed him. Why did he free him? Subhanallah. Listen to this now. He said, I heard the Prophet say, whoever picks up the pieces of food from a dining sheet, whoever picks it up and eats it, the food enters his stomach, the fire of hell is haram upon him and he's forgiven. And how can I keep a forgiven person as a slave of mine? I free you, go, you can go. Think about those who waste food. Huh? People say, but I can afford it. I can afford to get more. How can you say that I can afford it? Huh? What if Allah Jalla wa Ala takes it from you? Allah is the one who gives it to you. A lot of people, they do these kind of things, but nothing happens to them. They make a mistake, but no punishment comes to them. They commit a sin, and no punishment comes to them. They throw away the food, but nothing happens to them. But don't you think that that means, because it doesn't happen to you, and this is not the hukum of Sharia. No. Allah has given you ease. In reality, this is an azab from Allah Jalla wa Ala. In reality, it's a punishment from Allah Jalla wa Ala. How? Sayyidina Uqbat ibn Amir radiallahu ta'ala narrates that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, when you see someone in dunya, he is sinning, but he is still successful and he gets what he wants in life. We see that, don't we? A lot of people say, so-and-so is so sinful, but still a very successful person. He's so sinful, but he's still a multi-millionaire. He still has a lot of wealth, a lot of money. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, if you see someone who is sinning, but he is still blessed with that what he wants, that is an ease, a temporary ease given to him by Allah Jalla wa Ala. Meaning Allah has taken him from the list of his people. There was a time in his life when he used to sin and he used to be punished. There was a time in his life when he used to make a mistake and a signal used to come from Allah Jalla wa Ala. That's what Allah says in the Quran. Allah Jalla wa Ala says, فَلَمَّا نَسُوا مَا ذُكِّرُوا بِي فَتَحْنَا عَلَيْهِمْ بَابَ كُلِّ شَيْءٍ حَتَّى إِذَا فَرِحُوا. that there comes a time when they forget Allah. And Allah opens the doors of everything. They forget about Allah. When we were children, when we were young, we used to sin. If you commit a sin, azab would come. You commit a sin, you fail your exams. You commit a sin, you have an accident. You commit a sin, you fall ill. Signals come from Allah. And then there comes a time in your life when these signals stop coming. When messages stop coming. And you think, now everything is fine. How are you, Janab? Everything is fine. Allah's karam. Allah's blessed me with everything. Everything is fine. Why? Because you think now Satan is creating this whisper in your heart. He's creating this thought in your heart. Now everything is fine. Remember when you used to sin, a punishment used to come? Now you sin, no punishments come to you. So everything is fine. Perhaps Allah is happy with me now. Perhaps my Lord is happy with me now. Allah says, فَلَمَّا نَسُوا مَا ذُكِّرُوا بِي فَتَحْنَا عَلَيْهِمَ بَابَ كُلِّ شَيْءٍ حَتَّى إِذَا فَرِهُوا. When they completely forget about me, then there comes a time, I open the doors for them. I open all the doors for them. They will become multi-millionaires. They will have the best cars. They will have the best properties. They will be successful in everything. They will be successful in the university, in the colleges, in the education, in world, in everything. People will say, wow, amazing, how successful. Allah says, don't you think that you are beloved of Allah and Allah is pleased with you? Now Allah has taken you out of His list now. There was a time when you were His beloved and you used to be punished after sinning. Now the punishments have stopped coming, meaning now you will be punished in the hereafter, and that will be a severe punishment. This is what the Prophet said. When you see a person sinning and he's still happy and he has no problems in life, then remember that is just a temporary opening from Allah Jalla Wa'ala. In reality, Allah's wrath is falling upon that person. The Prophet said, this is the hadith of Rasulullah in the Musnad of Imam Ahmad bin Hanbal. When Allah wants good for people, when Allah wants good for people, He punishes them immediately after their sin within dunya. You see? When Allah wants something good for people, He punishes them immediately after sinning in dunya. So if you do something wrong and you are punished, if you do something wrong, you have an accident. If you do something wrong, you fail your exams. If you do something wrong, you have a loss in your trade, in your business. Then that means that you are still under the rahmah, under the mercy of Allah Jalla Wa'ala. You're not rejected now. So don't you say that, be happy, oh I'm fine, you're sinning, but still nothing is happening. Finally, the last point. So as I said, we will sit together and eat together, and we will not waste food in the month of Ramadan. That is point number 11, and the final 12th point for education and training in the month of Ramadan, which we will implement. Listen to me, everyone, those who are watching this program, all the viewers, make sure we act upon this for the coming 11 months, inshallah. That should be our intention. That should be our niyyah. It's not only for the month of Ramadan. We will strive and gain this training and use this training and utilize it, this for the coming 11 months, inshallah. The final point is go and visit the sick. Go and visit the ill people, the people who are in the hospitals in the month of Ramadan. This is very important. And there are many rewards of that. Many, many rewards. And especially those people for whom the doctors have given up. The physicians have said that this person will die. He has no chance to live and to survive. Meeting those people is very beneficial. A lot of the times we feel that we become ungrateful to what we have. But when you meet a person who's on his deathbed, when you will ask him about his life, when you will ask him how does he see dunya, when you will come out of that hospital, then when you will see life, he'll say, I'm mourning about my health, I'm mourning about my wealth, I'm mourning about my house, at least I'm blessed with life. This 25-year-old youngster, he's on his deathbed, he's about to leave dunya. When you will communicate with him, when you will talk to him, when you will come out of the hospital, you will thank Allah Jalla Wa'ala for all the blessings that you have. At least I have life. Then you will appreciate that and you will be grateful. Go to the graveyards. Make a habit of going to the graveyards, because the Qabristan will remind you of the hereafter. The Qabristan will remind you of your qabr. This was the 12th point. And again, as I said, there are many ahadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and many narrations about this. One narration, an Abi Hurairah radiyallahu ta'ala, and this is a beautiful narration. An Abi Hurairah radiyallahu ta'ala an an-nabiy sallallahu alayhi wasallam anna rajulan zara akhan lahu fi qaryatin fa arsala Allahu ta'ala ala madrajatihi malakan falamma ata alayhi qala ayna turid قال أريد أخني في هذه القرية قال هل لك عليه من نعمة تربها قال لا غير أني أحببته في الله قال إني رسول الله إليك بأن الله قد أحبك كما أحببته فيه رواه مسلم. Imam Muslim narrates this, that the Prophet ﷺ said, a man traveled to visit his brother. A man traveled to visit his brother. When he traveled to visit his brother, Allah Jalla wa'ala sent an angel. So this is point number 12. This is the final point. A person goes to visit his brother, and Allah sends the angel to wait on the path. And the angel says to him, "Where are you going?" He says, "I am going to meet my brother." He said, "Why are you going to meet your brother?" Now this is the importance of meeting people, visiting people, visiting those people who need you, and visiting those people, the poor people, the people who have illnesses, the people who are in the hospitals, visiting them for learning a lesson yourself and also for attaining the qurb of Allah Jalla wa'ala. Huh? So the angel was sent by Allah Jalla wa'ala. The angel said to him, "Where are you going, O person?" He said, "I'm going to meet my brother, a Muslim brother." He said, "Why are you going to meet him? Has he done a favor on you?" He said, "No, I'm only going to meet him for the sake of Allah Jalla wa'ala. I'm only going to meet him for the pleasure of Allah Jalla wa'ala." Do you know what the angel says? The angel said, "I am a messenger of Allah. Allah has sent me to meet you and to convey a message to you." What is the message of the angel? What is the message that is being conveyed by the angel and the message from Allah Jalla wa'ala? The angel says that Allah Jalla wa'ala has sent a message. "Anni أحببته في الله قال إني رسول الله إليك بأن الله قد أحبك كما أحببته." Allah Jalla wa'ala said, "The way you were saying that I am only traveling to meet him because I only love him for the sake of Allah, Allah's message is, now Allah is saying, the way you love him, now I love you and I've sent my angel to tell you that I have love for you. You become the beloved of Allah if you meet people." In the month of Ramadan, we will make niyyah that we will meet, and there are other ahadith to meet the marid, also the qabristan, and come out of that with by learning a message, by learning a lesson from the qabristan, that we will leave this dunya one day. These are the 12 points that we will all act upon, inshallah, in the month of Ramadan, and not only in the month of Ramadan, we will continue with this after the month of Ramadan. T, the first T stands for, second T stands for, third T stands for, fourth T stands for, thanking Allah Jalla wa'ala. Yeah, thankfulness. Taqwa divides into how many types? Three. The first is Allah is watching us. The second is refrain from bad company. The third is everything with the fadl of Allah. And each one has dua. Each one has dua. We will keep making dua. Second, training. How many points are in training? Three. First is tazkiyah of the mind and the heart. Second, how to fall in love with the ibadat, wudu, and all of these ahkam. Third, sila rahmi and enmity, hatred, dushmaniya, and join ties of relationship. And dua again, that. And third one is takbir, glorification, glorifying Allah Jalla wa'ala. And the batini meaning of that, in that there are three points. First is tilawat of Quran, hifz of Quran, memorizing salah translation and reading tafsir of Quran. Second point, durood upon the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, zikre paase and fas, istighfar. And then I told you what a samajdar bikari is, a wise beggar. Yes? And then the third one in that, dawah of deen. 30,000 hoors in the palace which has 30,000 gates, and every day they will see the person and they will say to you, "Oh, so and so, remember Alam Rock Road when you were walking in the streets of Alam Rock and you were giving dawah to people?" That is the conversation of the hoor. These are the hadith that I gave about dawah, and then dua in that also. Thanking Allah. First one, ihsas, showing solidarity to the poor people, feeling the pangs of hunger and thirst that the poor people are going through. Sadaqah, giving your children sadaqah, getting them to give sadaqah, shukr, ni'mah, before you eat and drink, stop for a bit and think, if I didn't have this, then how would I live without this food? And thank Allah that Allah has blessed you with it. Second, eat together. Do not waste the food. Eat together with family. Eat together. That will create muhabba in your heart. And do not throw away the food. Not waste the food. Pick up the food which is on the floor and eat it. There's so much reward of that. And I mentioned the benefits of that. And finally, the 12th point was, visit the ill people and visit the marid and go to the qabristan. Allahu Jalla wa'ala accept this, and Allah accept all your efforts. Jazakumullahu khaira wa ahsan al jaza wa akhiru da'wana alhamdulillahi rabbil alameen. And if you have any questions, my email address is given on the screen of AYQ TV, and you can send the questions there. Jazakumullahu khaira wa ahsan al jaza wa akhiru da'wana alhamdulillahi rabbil alameen. Ramadan, Ramadan, ya Habib. sallallahu ala muhammadin nabiy ul ummi wa ala alihi wa sahbihi wa barik wa sallim wa salli alayh. Muhtaram hibba, aaj ka wazifa quwwat e hafiza ke liye hai. Agar aapka hafiza kamzor hai, memory kamzor hai, to aap ye wird padhenge to inshaallah iski barkat se aapka hafiza mazboot hoga. Quwwat e hafiza ke liye aaj ka ye wird aap note kar lijiye. Allahumma nawwir qalbi bi'ilmik washrah sadri binur ma'rifatik واستعمل بدني بتاعتك وبارك وسلم. اللهم نظر قلبي بعلمك واشرح صدري بنور معرفتك واستعمل بدني بطاعتك وبارك وسلم. یہ وظیفہ آپ نے ہر روز سات مرتبہ پڑھنا ہے, ہر روز سات مرتبہ پڑھنا ہے, اول آخر درود شریف. اس کی برکت سے اللہ جل وعلا آپ کو قوت حافظہ عطا فرمائے گا, آپ کا حافظہ مضبوط ہوگا. اللہ اس کی برکات عطا فرمائے. اس کے ساتھ ساتھ ہر نماز کے فرضوں کے بعد, ہر نماز کے فرضوں کے بعد اپنا دایاں ہاتھ, اپنا رائٹ ہینڈ اپنے ماتھے پہ رکھ کر, اپنا دایاں ہاتھ رائٹ ہینڈ اپنے ماتھے پہ رکھ کر یا قویو 11 مرتبہ پڑھنا ہے اول آخر درود شریف. یا قویو 11 مرتبہ, 11 ٹائمز اول آخر درود شریف. اور پھر اللہم رب زدنی علما, رب زدنی علما, رب زدنی علما, یہ 3 مرتبہ پڑھنا ہے اول آخر درود شریف. اس کی برکت سے اللہ جل وعلا آپ کو قوت حافظہ عطا فرمائے گا. اللہ علی محمد النبی الامی وعلی آلہ وصحبہ وبارک وسلم وصلی علیہ. Brothers and sisters in Islam, today's litany, Ramadan gift, is for strengthening your memory. This is for the strength of memory. So if you have a weak memory, inshallah, if you recite this with the blessings of this, Allahu Jalla wa'ala will strengthen your memory. This is to recite, Allahumma nawwir qalbi bi'ilmik, washrah sadri binuri ma'rifatik, wasta'mil badani bita'atik, وبارك وسلم. اللهم نور قلبي بعلمك واشرح صدري بنور معرفتك واستعمل بدني بطاعتك وبارك وسلم. You recite this 7 times daily with درود upon the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam before and after it. With the blessings of this, inshallah, Allah jalla wa'ala will strengthen your memory. And additionally, after every salah, after the fara'id of every salah, after the fard of every prayer, you recite Ya Kaviyu. Place your right hand on your forehead and you recite Ya Kaviyu 11 times. And you send blessings upon the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam before and after it. And then after that, you recite Allahumma Rabbi Zidni Ilma 3 times. And again, durood upon the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam before and after it. And also it's important that do remember the prerequisites, the conditions, the sharait to gain maximum benefit from these awrad, and that is to work on self-purification, purification of the mind, purification of the heart, purification of the soul. And if you work on that, inshallah, you will gain maximum benefits from these awrad. If you are constantly sinning, if you are disobeying Allahu Jalla wa'ala, and then you say that the awrad are not working for me, then you have not heard my lectures on the prerequisites and the conditions of acceptance and benefiting from these awrad. If you act upon that, inshallah, each and every wird will work miraculously for you, inshallah, and you will see the benefits of all of these awrad. Allahu Jalla wa'ala accept all the efforts of all the members of Kanzul Huda and all of you brothers and sisters in Islam who have been attending these lectures throughout the month of Ramadan, and all our viewers worldwide who have been watching these lectures. May Allah Jalla wa'ala bless you all with the barakat of Ramadan al-Mubarak. And do not forget that this is the month of training. We are trained in this blessed month of Ramadan al-Mubarak, and these 30 days were for training. And inshallah, after this, we will use this training for the coming 11 months to implement the teachings and the spiritual strength and the spiritual quwwa that we have achieved in the month of Ramadan. We will use that for the coming 11 months, inshallah. Remember, Ramadan is all about taqwa. And if you were sinning in the month of Ramadan, we still have the opportunity, we still have the time to make special tawbah, khas tawbah, pure tawbah, so that this guest of Allahu Jalla wa'ala, Ramadan al-Mubarak, is not displeased with us. Ramadan al-Mubarak.